Hello, I'm Marc Desgroseilliers from Technical Support here at Pix4D, and today I want to talk to you about georeferencing. So, why would I want to have georeferencing in my project? Well, first of all, it allows you to place the project on the Earth, and so it makes it nicer to handle your different projects, and it's always nice to know where your project was exactly. Second, it will provide scale and orientation to your project. And so if the geolocation data is accurate and precise, you will be able to make measurements in your project, which is always a plus. In the case of image geolocation, it will also reduce processing time because the mapper will know which images are close to each other and it will make the matching of these images easier. And in the case of ground control points, having ground control points will reduce error accumulation in your project. So, I already said it once. What do I mean by ground control points or GCPs? These are characteristic features or objects that have been placed on the scene and for which the GPS coordinates have been measured and recorded. And when I talk about image geolocation or image geotags, then these are the GPS coordinates of where the image was taken. So how are you going to acquire this data? Well, in the case of GCPs, you can either use a GPS station, which is a very precise instrument that typically you have on a tripod. And otherwise, you can also use a total station, or you can use online services such as Google Maps. However, you should keep in mind that GPS stations are much more precise than Google Maps, for example. For the image geolocation, well, typically this is going to be a GPS module in your drone, and it can either be a consumer grade GPS module or an RTK GPS logger. The second one would have a much more precise recording of the GPS coordinates. So, about GCPs. One question that we get very often is how many should I put in my project? Because it's a bit cumbersome to acquire them. Acquiring more GCPs takes more time. So how many do I need? Well, the strict minimum would be 3. And what we would recommend is more between 5 or 8 GCPs per project. These GCPs should be well spread out. And it's a good idea if you have a feature of interest to have at least one GCP not too far from it. Another thing to keep in mind is that you shouldn't have them all in a straight line, because then this will give a degree of freedom and it will allow error to sneak in. And one last comment about the number of GCPs is that there is some kind of law of diminishing returns, in the sense that if you add more and more GCPs, the increase in accuracy will decrease. So, really, if you have more than 10 or 12 GCPs, we recommend that any further GCP be converted to a checkpoint, and then this will allow you to assess the accuracy of the project more fairly. Now, I want to talk about the different methods of acquiring this geolocation data and what kind of accuracy you can expect. So for a survey grade GPS logger, so either a GPS station on its tripod or an RTK GPS module on your drone, you can expect an accuracy of about 2 centimeters. If it's a consumer grade GPS on your drone, then you can expect an accuracy of between 5 and 10 meters, which is similar to what you can expect from Google Earth or Google Maps if you take your GCP from this data source. So that's one thing to keep in mind, is that more precise GCPs will yield more benefits and more accurate geolocation. So let's see in the mapper how we can add GCPs in the project. We will see 2 ways how to add GCPs in your project. So the first way is after the first step, like this here, if you know where you can find your GCPs, or if your project is not georeferenced yet, so you don't have image geolocation,
the mapper cannot make the link between the GCP coordinates and the project coordinates. So you will have to navigate your point cloud and find the GCPs in the project. So for example, I know that I have a GCP around here. Here it is, the red mark. And I can add a tie point. I can call it GCP1. Make sure change it to 3D GCP. And then I can enter the coordinates, whatever they are, that I've measured on the ground while I was flying. And then I can start marking the images. And apply. And I would need to do this for all of my GCPs. So this is the procedure if I don't have image geolocation. Let me delete this one because I kind of made up these coordinates. Remove point. Okay, there you go. The other method is if I have a text file with the coordinates of the GCPs. So let me go in the GCP window and import GCPs. I can browse to the text file, which I've saved here, inputs. There you go. And now my GCPs, they appear. You see the coordinates are imported. This was all in the text file. So now I can just say OK. And my GCPs, they appear in the project as blue marks. Now, you will see that my blue marks are below my project. And that was intentional. That's because I did not choose the correct vertical system. So let me go back. And you see here, you can choose the GCP coordinate system. So I'm going to edit it. And here I go in the advanced options, and you see I have the height as the geoid, and but I know that in this particular case the GCPs were in MSL, so I choose the appropriate coordinate system. Okay, and now you see my blue marks, they line up much better with my project. So what I can do is I can click this point here, and you see it the blue mark is the where the coordinates point, and they're not too far from my actual mark, so it makes it very easy to click the GCP in the images because I don't have to hunt around in my project. You see already here this is where it is, so I keep clicking and I apply, and you see now the green mark is here. I can maybe make it a bit better. The green mark is on the red GCP. It's okay that the blue mark is off because the blue mark was the initial coordinate system, so that's fine. And that's how you can add your GCPs, either with or without image geolocation.